Hello, everyone. This is Roman Bagamazov, and this is another session, session number five of the Wyckoff Trading Institute for the Chinese market. And today we're going to discuss the major differences between accumulation and distribution. And then we will conclude our analysis of the sectors that are left. There are only three sectors that are left for us to look at. And that's the plan for today's session.
大家好，今天是4月6号，这是我们魏科夫交易研究所，第五次视频，这里是罗蒙马佐夫教授，伯格马佐夫教授。然后今天呢，我们要谈的是吸筹区间与派发区间的主要区别，这两个区间，这个区间的主要区别是什么？另外呢，我们将完成我们的行业指数的分析，现在剩下三个行业指数了。
I'd like to thank my student, Zhao Galbin, for translating the session as usual. And also, I want to mention a couple of things that we received as a feedback from you.
首先呢，感谢赵国本先生，我的学生，他给我做担任翻译工作。另外呢，我也要感谢大家为我们视频所做的回复和给我们发的邮件。
One of the things that was mentioned, and we know about this, was the quality of the videos. And unfortunately, on Youku, the transition from our video to the Youku video loses that quality. We cannot figure out, at least at this point of time, how to change this. If you have any suggestions, please email us, and we'll be glad to do. For now, we're just trying to increase the size of the letters so that you would see the letters better in the video.
首先回复一下大家给我们的建议啊，因为很多朋友都说我们的视频内容清晰度不是很高，建议改成高清的。这里面呢有一个情况，因为优酷啊，把我们的视频上传到优酷以后，不知道为什么清晰度立刻就变低了。我们现在还没有想出办法来改善这个情况，所以说罗蒙教授呢，他首先的做法就是把这个很多中文字已经变大了。如果您知道。这种情况就是说，我们怎么样上传视频以后还能够达到高清晰度的话，请你给我们指教，也谢谢大家。
So we apologize for this quality, and hopefully in the future we'll figure out the way how to make the quality of the video better.
非常抱歉，现在清晰度不是很高。希望呢，我们在不久的将来能够找到办法改善这个清晰度。
Also, some of you have asked through the email if the slides from the sessions are available, and they are available. The only problem is how for us to get those slides to you. So we are gonna open in the near future a blog page where all of the links to all of the videos and all of the slides will be available.
有一些朋友呢也问我们这些培训视频的课件能不能给大家，然后罗蒙老师说当然可以，希望呢我们将来在最近开一个小博客，或者是我们把罗蒙老师的这个网页给公布给大家，然后大家把自己的邮件放上去，然后我们就可以把课件发给大家。
As usual, you could send us emails to wyckofftrading@hotmail.com, either in Chinese or English, and within a couple of days we could generally reply to those emails. So thank you for sending those to us.
和以前一样，大家可以给我们那个 Wyckoff Trading at hotmail.com，然后发邮件，这样呢，我们就知道谁对这个东西感兴趣了，然后我们在几天之内就立刻回复你的邮件。
All right, great. Well, now let's jump to our material for today. And the first slide that we have is on the differences between accumulation and a distribution.
好，那我们现在先谈吸筹区间和派发区间的主要区别在哪里？
And the main two things that I would like you to remember on a very, very basic level of understanding how this method works, because there are a lot of body of knowledge that you have to know in order to use this methodology, and there are a lot of details and nuances. But on a very, very basic level, I want you to understand that in the accumulation, the main idea behind institutional presence is going to be the absorption of the supply and an ability of the prices to go lower or significantly lower.
有两点呢，我希望大家能够记住，因为你知道，在威克夫方法中有很多很多的因素啊，有很多很多的细节，我们将来会学到。我们希望大家都变成威克夫的专家，但是呢，那都需要时间，需要来学习。但目前来讲，我们希望大家记住最重要的两点，那就是在吸筹期间的时候，这个机构，这个大机构，或者是咱们所谓的庄家，他最主要就是说。 他要把所有的这个浮筹这个供应被吸收掉，然后呢，而且是让在这个整个过程中，大家可以看到的就是，到了这个阶段以后，价格已经无法继续下跌了，因为庄家在吸筹价格，所以说无法下跌。
In the distribution, the process is different, opposite to the accumulation. On the contrary, the supply is going to increase throughout the trading of the whole consolidation. And the prices will not be able at some point to make new advances to the upside.
在派发区间呢，刚好和吸筹区间相反，在这个派发区间里面，这个供应量在这个区间将持续增大，有可能会一直在增大，而且它的价格呢无法显著继续攀升。
And someone might say that, well, how is it possible? I see that even on this schematic, the prices are actually declining below the area of the climactic action in the accumulation. And then the prices are actually advancing above the climactic action in the distribution. And what we are saying is that there is no significant progression of prices to the downside below the area of the accumulation during absorption of the supply and accumulation, or there is no significant progress of the prices to the upside in the distribution.
有些朋友就问了，说老师，你这个是不是有点自相矛盾？因为即使在你这个示意图上，你发现没有，你这二次测试和弹簧效应的时候。 都会比前期的抛售高潮的低，你怎么能说价格无法继续下跌呢？这里我们大家讲的是无法显著下跌，也就是这个下跌在这个波动的一个下跌里面有一点点，比原来低是可能的，但我们说的是无法显著大量的下跌。在派发区间的示意图里面呢，也是说这个价格无法显著攀升，也就是它这个上升的量、上升的幅度不足以构成一个继续。 让这个上升这个趋势无法延续，无法继续延续。
And if we are talking about the supply and how the price reacts to the supply, accumulation should look something like this, where we have a lot of supply in phase A and early phase B, where we have supply contracting going into phase B, and then going into phase C, supply either going to increase or it's going to decrease. Meanwhile, it happens on the background of where the prices cannot significantly go lower. So therefore, this inability of the price to go lower is going to be seen in the contraction of the spread or the distance that the reactions are traveling is also going to contract, and then we might have some kind of attempts to go down like we have in phase C, which will be associated with temporary commitment to the downside, and then failure to continue the move to the downside. So in other words, the price will reverse. But it all starts with the supply signature.
那我们再谈谈供应在这个整个区间的变化。在吸筹区间的时候， 供应是逐渐被吸收的，也就是它在阶段 A 的时候，它的供应量最大，然后到了阶段 B 呢，供应量就减少。到阶段 C 的时候呢，有一个比较特别有意思的，它就是这个供应量可增加可减少，但是在 phase 阶段 C 的时候啊，我们将看到几种情况。第一个呢是价差要逐渐减少，逐渐减少。第二呢是它的距离，也就是它在一段一段在下降嘛，这个下降的距离缩小了。第三呢，有可能在阶段 C 的时候，它暂时的会突破这个支撑向下，但是呢，它不会继续向下走，也就是说这个继续向下失败。
So as we see supply being absorbed either through the absorption through the consolidation or a more violent absorption when absorption happens really quick on the way up, the main thing in the accumulation range is the decrease of the volatility, and at the same time, we want to see the decrease of the result to the downside, decrease of the progress to the downside.
从那个供应和振幅来讲，我们希望在这个从阶段 A 到阶段 C 的时候，它的振幅是不断的缩小的，而且它的向下下跌的幅度，也就这个结果下跌的幅度也是在不断的缩小。
And obviously, if we talk about the supply, this means that we talk about institutional presence. What do institutions do with the shares that they have? Are they active buyers or are they active sellers? And obviously, this is always on the background for us to create a wake of story, a wake of institutional stories as to what institutions are doing right now in the trading range.
当我们探讨吸筹区间和派发区间的时候，我们主要是在通过这些供应量和通过价格的这个结构，我们在推测大机构或者是庄家他的意图在什么？庄家在这个区间里面，他是在买还是在卖？这是我们最主要需要分析的工作。
For the distribution picture is opposite. We want to see an increase of the supply, and that increase of the supply is going to be shown to us in the increase of the down spread. It's going to be shown to us in the increase in the distance of the reactions to the downside, and it all going to lead to the general increase in volatility. And this is where result to the downside is going to start increasing as well. And that's the main difference between how supply behaves in the distribution compared to the accumulation.
在派发区间呢，它刚好和吸筹区间相反，也就是在派发区间里，它的供应量是逐渐增大的，而且在这个过程中，它的价差增大了，而且它向下的下跌的距离增加了，也就是在整个区间，它的振幅是增加的，而且呢，它的下跌的幅度，就是下跌的这个幅度也增加。
And the trick here with the distribution is just to observe the reactions and start looking at those reactions and how volatility starts to increase there and how the result starts to increase. And also on the background of the failures of the demand to advance the prices higher.
也就是在这个派发区间呢，我们最主要的就是观察在这个区间内它的下跌这个波段的变化，下跌的波段随着这个下跌的波段里面呢，它的价差会增加，这增加，而且下跌的幅度也会增加，而且在与此同时，我们看到的需求的失败，也就是它需求的时候，它不有个向上的波段嘛，一个向上的波段的不断的失败，加上这个下降波段的逐渐增加和下降的时候，价差的增大，振幅的增大，这个时候我们可以判断这是派发区间。
And in some instances, it's going to be extremely difficult for us to identify whether what the bias is, accumulation or a distribution. And it takes some time to develop that skill. The knowledge of how to do this is not enough. You have to practice, and you have to practice a lot.
在很多时候，我们大家都知道，分析并不见得是一件容易的事情，而且很多的时候呢，这个区间它也在不断的发展，在这个发展过程中，我们很难判断它这个突破的方向是向上的还是向下的。我们光有知识还没有用，我们需要很多的实际的分析和实际的实践，来看大量的图，才能够掌握这个分析的技巧。
Because some of the structural spots are going to look the same. For instance, we are seeing a reaction as a sign of weakness reaction in the distribution. We could see the same type of the reaction in the accumulation, which would be a spring. So what, how would we differentiate? And in some instances, the character with which the price moves could be a key for us to identify whether there is more of the selling by strong hands in the distribution or the selling by weak hands in the accumulation. We also could define the bias based on the previous action, what is happening in phases A and B of the trading range. And then the third one would be just a very tactical thing to do, and that is, what does the price do after it tries to commit to the downside on the specific characteristics? So we would be talking about trading tactics here. And in all of these cases, you kind of could see that tactics could help us out to define a specific point of analysis that we're seeking.
很多时候呢，在这个区间里面，很多的地方这个结构啊是很难区别的。比方说，在派发区间里面，刚才罗教授他指了一下这个区间，也就是这个下降波段和这个下降波段，它看起来是非常相似的，而且呢，它也是上升突破一定点，然后大幅下降。这个时候我们怎么判断呢？第一呢，我们可以根据它这两个波段的特点来分析。看看这个，这都是在卖的波段，就是卖量增加的波段。我们要可以通过它的特点分析，这个卖是庄家在卖，是大机构在卖，还是散户在卖？通过这个过程中的这个蜡烛图的特点，我们可以分析出来。第二呢，就是根据阶段 A 和阶段 B 这里面的特点来做分析，也就是在这个特点里面它有什么不同，它是倾向于吸收呢，还是在倾向于派发？第三个呢，就是说从这个它就是这个下降波段的末期，就是这个完成以后，它在接下来它做的是什么？他说这个 tactic，它这个时候的特点也可以帮助我们来分析这个区间是吸收区间呢，还是派发区间。
Tactics is a little bit more advanced concept, so we're probably gonna talk about this down the road, but I want to mention this to you for some of you who are a little bit more advanced in Wyckoff studies or generally in technical analysis. You might kind of see my point already, that, and sometimes I tell my students, you might be wrong about your analysis, but if you use tactics correctly, you still can profit, from trading.
这个 taxi 呢，他认为特别重要。这个重要在于什么地方呢？就是很多时候啊，学生说，他就跟学生讲，他说你的分析有可能是错的，但是如果你要是在技巧方面用得非常好的话，你还是可以赚钱。让我问一下罗老师，再把这个 tactics 再加强解释一下，好不好？excuse me, Roman, can you explain more about the tactics? You are not talking about test, right?
No, tactics is different. Tactics is all about what do we do, what kind of scenarios are we going to have at this spot. So, for instance, this upthrust could be so similar to what we're seeing here in the sign of strength and the backing up action. So, understanding the scenarios that under one scenario the price could continue going up. So that's scenario number one. And then under the second scenario, the price could go lower and fail. So understanding those scenarios, we could tactically position ourselves to benefit from either move, either to the upside or to the downside.
我刚才让罗老师讲，再把这个 tactics 详细解释一下啊。然后呢，他说这个 tactics 它重要点呢在于什么呢？它是咱们所说的策略分析。比方说，在这个强势出现和这个这段这叫什么上冲回落，比方说在这一段时候，看着结构来说它比较相似，但是呢，它具体是什么东西？我们呢，有可能也分析不对，但是我们要有交易策略对的话，不管它是哪一种情况，我们都会赚钱。就是说，它根据不同的情况，有不同的策略来应对。
All right. So as I mentioned before, I really would like you to study in details and remember all of the Wyckoff elements, all of the Wyckoff events that would happen during accumulation and during distribution. And we've given you two of the slides here that Joe Gobin translated for you. So please do study because we're going to refer to all of these events more and more, and we're going to refer to phases more and more. And if you would like to continue studying with us, you really, really need to remember and to have those. So please print those out, have it in front of you, and study those.
然后呢，罗老师再次强调了，这个魏科夫派发区间的事件和吸筹区间事件的重要性。他说他在讲课中会不断的提到某一个事件、某一个阶段，然后呢，希望大家能把这两张幻灯片打印出来，贴在自己的墙上，能够不断的看到。你在看视频的时候，也可以不断的去看，哎，这里讲到哪里了，它的特点是什么？希望大家能够熟悉。
All right, great. So now let's look at the last three sectors that we need to discuss. So we're going to discuss today consumer staples, telecommunication services, and utilities.
今天我们完成所有的行业指数。那么今天有三个，一个是上证消费、上证电信和上证公用。
And again, the reason why we are looked first in the first two sessions at the market indices, Shanghai and Shenzhen composites, is because we're using a top-bottom approach where we look at the market first, then we go into the sectors and we're trying to identify which sectors are behaving better or worse and what kind of price structure do they have. And then after that, we can go to a lower level, either an industry group or the stocks.
大家还记得罗老师的第一个视频，他讲的其实是整个大势的情况。他为什么这么讲呢？而且在讲这个，然后再讲这个各个行业。其实这也是分析的顺序，从上到下。他希望大家以后分析也是，首先看大势的情况怎么样，就综合指数怎么样，情况怎么样，然后再看行业指数，然后再从行业里，在你给重点行业或者是很强的行业里，再选出股票，然后这样逐层分析。
So let's look at the consumer staples, the weekly chart.
那么现在看，主要消费行业周线图。
And I was really surprised to see quite a different price structure than any other sectors that we looked at in the previous sessions.
这个主要消费行业，它的周线图呢，它的蜡烛图、K 线图和其他咱们以前讲过的行业都不一样。
The first thing that caught my eye is that the initial decline was not that severe as we see in other sectors, and that was showing an element of strength right away.
首先来说，让他第一眼就能看到的，就是说最开始的下降没有像以前其他的行业那样，那么下降程度那么多。这首先来说，就第一次下降没有那么多，这就是一个强势。
The second distinction from other price structures in other sectors was that their regional trading range was quite compact relative to other sectors and how the price structure developed there. So it clearly had all of the phases that we needed, A, B, and C, and D phase, where in phases A, we had a stopping action with the test, and with the change of character on the automatic rally, where in phase B, we had a lower low, which defined a sign of weakness for the secondary test. And then we had a spring, another lower low. But the absorption of the supply has happened both on the way down and then on the way up.
首先呢，他说他非常喜欢这张图的第二个原因就是说，在这个整个的下降过程中啊，它包含了我们所有的魏科夫吸筹区间所有的阶段和事件都非常清晰，和其他的行业轴线图不太一样。大家可以看到，在这个阶段 A、阶段 B、阶段 C 的时候，和它向上走的时候，所有的这个吸筹的这发生在各个区间之内都有。
Another three elements of strength for the consumer staples, staples were the reaccumulation range or a stepping stone trading range that has happened on the way up. And it had a slightly different structure than other sectors. Other sectors has had the price maybe just traveling down, this is an upsloping range, and by the way, I have put here also all of the phases, and we could see how phase C has the LPS or a spring type of action, which tries to take the price down, and yet it can't, so there is an absorption of the supply in this area right here. But by itself, the fact that it's upsloping and it's resting on the levels of the resistance that were defined by the previous trading range shows an element of strength.
再一点呢，罗教授讲的就是它有一个叫做脚踏实的再吸筹区间，而这个区间呢，它是个上斜的区间。大家可以看到整个上斜区间它也划分了阶段 A、B、C、D， 然后也就是说所有的五脏俱全和以前的那些个标这个阶段和事件都差不多。但是这个再吸收区间它是个上斜的区间，而且它也有弹簧效应或者是说最后支撑点，这一点通过这一点的时候也有一部分的吸筹，也就是这个吸筹在整个区间里无所不在。
Another element of strength was the last move to the upside. And we see that not only the character of this move has leadership characteristics as the price advances beyond a lot of levels of the resistance, but more importantly, it had an ability to commit above the resistance that was created by this ending action, the climactic action on the way up in the previous cycle. And the price not only touched it, but it actually closed above it, which is a significant point of strength.
还有一个强势的现象呢，就是这个行业比其他行业强的现象呢，就是说它突破了前期，也就是2015年那一波上涨的高点，而且你可以看到它这个突破的过程中都非常强，这个K线走得非常强，而且它是突破了前面的高点。
And the last point of strength for us is all in the more current structure, where the price was trying to go down, and yet there is no ability of the price to go significantly lower beyond the levels that are defined by the long-term resistance and also the up channel that we see here from the lows in 2016 and the lows in 2017.
再有一个强势的表现呢，就是说最近的这个盘整的区间，这个盘整区间呢，大家可以看到它有下降的这个意愿，就是下降的这个势头，但是呢，它并没有突破很多，这个在这个区间内没有突破很多，还在这个区间内盘整。
So in general, we would say that this particular sector has exhibited a lot of leadership characteristics. And the biggest question that we have is all about a current structure. Is this leadership still in place? And what kind of price structure supports that leadership? Would we have a continuation move to the upside? Or after being a leader, would the shares of this particular sector and stocks be sold if the market goes down?
那么我们可以从这一点呢，可以看到这个行业是个领涨行业，或者是领涨的这个股票。那么通过我们要确定它是不是真正的领涨者，还要再看哪呢？看到近期的这个盘整的情况。那么在整个大势下降的时候，我们看到这个行业或它的构成的股票，它的卖的量有多大？也就是在这个大势不好的时候，是不是有大量的股票被卖出去？
So therefore, let's look at the daily chart.
那我们正好，那看这个的话，就要看一下日线图。
And again, we're looking at the move to the upside that had a lot of leadership characteristics. It has concluded with the climactic action. There is some of the increase of the volume signature and the spread that we see on the move to the upside. But more importantly, the next reaction has shown to us a change of character. This reaction is something of a different kind, much more than what we've seen before on the way up. So therefore, the conditions have changed from uptrend to consolidation, and we could expect some kind of trading range, action.
通过这个日线图呢，我们看到一开始的它的上涨这一块儿，我们可以看到它是一个领涨行业的上涨特点。然后上涨到这儿了以后呢，到经过抢购高潮的时候，我们可以看到，到抢购高潮的这个阶段，它的这个成交量还是比较高。然后到下跌的时候，自动下跌这个波段的时候，我们为什么定义它为自动下跌呢？罗老师画了几条线，就是在这个。也就是它自动下跌的，就这个距离要比前面这个调整的距离要大得多，所以我们把它这个自动下跌这个波段叫做特性改变。
The change of character is a reaction between the high of the buying climax and the low of the automatic reaction. It just basically tells us that we are done with the uptrend, and we most likely are going to consolidate. And then we have a series of tests, one test in phase A, which is trying to test the high of the climactic action. There is an attempt to go down, but it's been reversed, so there is still some strength associated with the previous momentum, and the price still tries to get out of the trading range. But then supply is coming in, and this is all an element of phase B, where we would have an attempt to go up on the upthrust type of action, which still is a test to the previous highs, and then an increase in volatility and quick move to the downside, to the support.
我们说特性改变，大家已经说了，就是说它下降的幅度比以前大，而且它这段距离呢是指从抢购高潮到自动下跌，就这个低点这段时间的距离。我们看到了特性改变，就知道哦，那么以前的上升趋势已经结束了，我们现在恐怕进入盘整阶段。进入盘整阶段以后呢，到了这个二次测试，二次测试它的目的就是要测试这个原来的抢购高潮，我们现在还有没有需求能够超过这个前面抢购高潮的高点？然后呢，经过这块不能超过以后，然后呢，它就开始有下跌。但这个大家看到，下跌并没有跌那么大，这个下跌的幅度只是到这儿。然后呢，以前的需求量就通过前一波上面的需求量继续推动价格向上涨。然后这也是呢，其实也是一测试，也就看看这波的需求到底有多大。它呢确实是比抢购高潮高了，但是它也没有高多少，所以说在经过二次测试以后，价格又继续下跌了，这是阶段 B 的典型表现。
And remember our discussion at the top of this session about the differences between accumulation and the distribution. If we look at these two reactions that we have had so far, the most significant reactions, we could see that the level of supply is increasing, volatility, the level of volatility is increasing as the spread is increasing. And there is more of the distance increase in the reaction. So that suggests some kind of distribution qualities to what we're experiencing right now. It doesn't really mean that we are done with reaccumulation. There might be a possible reaccumulation down the road. But if supply is increasing, then we need to have some kind of testing absorption qualities for a reaccumulation. If those are not going to come, then most likely we are in the distribution.
大家还记不记得我们在这个视频的最开始的时候，我们讲了吸筹区间和派发区间的特点，和它重要区别。在这个重要区别里面呢，就是首先有一条，就是说在整个的区间范围内，如果这个成交量是逐步增大的，成交量逐步增大的，像罗老师的刚才画的，而且呢，它的价差和振幅都在增加，下降的距离也在增加，这个时候它就有派发的特性和派发的可能。我们通过这点呢，我们从这张图上来说，到目前来讲，我们说它有一定派发的特性，但这并不代表它不可能是一个再吸收区间，因为这个股票它是股票的价格这个趋势啊，它是不断的发展的。我们在这里面我们要看到，哎，它有这个派发的特点。将来呢，我们要看它有没有需求上涨的特点。如果没有需求上涨的话，它有可能是派发。但如果这个有需求的话，我们要继续观察，因为我们要综合分析。
Also, we could look at the rallies that we have had. So we had this biggest rally to the upside, then another attempt to go up. And what is happening more recently?Well, there is really no progression to the upside. So that shows us how demand is becoming so much weaker. And we could see that the demand is contracting based on the different areas where on the rally, we definitely see a contraction of demand from one area to another. So that usually tells us that demand is becoming of poor quality.
我们刚才分析了下降波段，那么现在呢，我们看一看上涨波段。罗老师画了几条这个上涨这个线，我们可以看到这个上涨线呢，在逐段的这个高度啊，在不断的缩小，这个幅度在不断的缩小。而且在成交量上来说，它这个需求在这个上涨线上涨 K 线的时候的相对应的成交量也在不断的减低，这说明什么呢？这说明需求在不断的缩量。
And of course, for us, the traders, we need to understand how we will trade this market and specifically what's happening at the end of the chart. And I just want to make sure that we all understand here. This is from April 4th, the last date here. And what we see here in this particular area is a lot of effort increase.We have not seen this effort throughout the whole structure where there is an attempt to sell, yet it doesn't really has a big result. So from this picture here, we are thinking that there should be some kind of stop in action, a temporary stop in action, a possible short-term reversal, and maybe a short-term change of character. And we kind of see it in this, in the point number two and point number three. And we see that there is a continuation to the upside. So for a bullish scenario, what we would need to do is we would need to commit above the local area of the resistance and to overcome this. Unfortunately, with a lot of talks between the US and China,on tariffs. We have a lot of news that are coming to the market and they just basically producing some kind of short-term volatility event and the whole price structure changes. So I believe that with the market open on Monday and we still have some kind of negative sentiment around tariffs, we probably would be thinking that the price should be somewhere closer to the support area.
罗老师讲了最近股市的变化，大家可以看到在这个阶段它 它相对应的是这个成交量的增加，在这段时间呢，也就是成交量增加了，这个这个 K 线的形态啊，它其实是一个Doji 的形态，或者是这个星态，这个叫十字星，或者是这个什么的形态，也就是这个形态呢增加了，但是呢上升幅度也不大，下降的幅度也不大，而这个时候呢，它其实是振幅比较大，就上上下下上上下下不是很确定。那么看了这个点一二三。到第三点的时候呢，其实它，大家看到这是4月3号，这是4月4号，最后这个K线是4月4号的这个线，也就是这个时候的新闻啊，还没有那么那么激烈。那么看通过这个4月4号呢，它的 K 线还是向上的，但是如果是股市走强的话，如果超过前面这一段阻力的话，我们希望看到的是一个 K 线迅速超过，而且呢停留在这里。但是呢，我们知道最近的新闻比较负面，周一呢，周一开盘的时候，有可能因为负面的新闻啊，有可能会股市一下子要测试这个底部了。大家看周一的开盘会怎么样？比方因为最近的股市走向都和新闻有关。
So again, short term, very small trading range, very well defined resistance and the support. So we want to understand what the price will do in the short term future. Would this be an upthrust where the price just commits temporarily and then comes back? So then we would be talking about a possible target right here. Or if the price goes down and then recovers back and overcomes the points of the resistance, then we would be thinking that consumer staples could have an interest for us because it's been outperforming for quite some time and we should look into the stocks there. One of the ways to deal with this type of the scenarios is to look through the stocks in this sector and to define which ones are leading stocks. This is where institutions are unwilling to sell those stocks and which ones are weaker, meaning that those stocks are under institutional distribution and in a possible downtrend.
大家看到最近的交易区间比较窄，都是这个交易区间内有交易间，交易间这个这是大的，比较中型的，这是一个中间是一个比较小型的。所以说周一开盘以后，我们看到如果周一的开盘是向下了，也就是说这一点是上冲回落，那么有可能价格就会测试这个底部。如果周一的开盘以后，它只是到了小型的交易区间的底部，然后立刻反升了，那么这个情况就比较有意思了。由于前期我们看到这个行业一直是领涨行业，而且它是比较强，那么它的趋向就有可能会突破这个窄幅的交易区间向上走。我们还有一个办法呢，就是说我们要看这个行业内的股票，看看其他股票个股它的变化情况是怎么样，它有没有在股市大势都在向下的时候，它这个成交量却反倒低，也就是说，行家，也就是说这个主要庄家或者是大的机构，他不愿意卖，在股票在大势低迷的情况下，它的成交量反倒低，也就是人家不愿意卖的时候，这种股票是比较强势的股票。
All right, well, now let's look at the next sector, which is a telecommunication services. And as you could see, the structure is so different from what we've seen from the consumer staples. We see that the initial move to the downside is so much more. It negates a lot of the profit that we have had on the way up right here. So right away, we see that relative to the consumer staples, there is more weakness.
那么现在看一下上证电信业务。首先呢，罗老师讲了这段初始的下降这一段，看它的下降幅度多么大。从这一点来说，我们就说它比上证消费那个行业要弱得多。
We also see that the spread in phases A and B are still relatively high, and they're probably somewhat higher than for the consumer staples, another point of weakness. And then our reaccumulation range in the middle of this larger range is not upsloping. It's actually more horizontal, as well as there is some weakness on the way up. And this rally does not obviously come to the point of the long-term resistance on the climactic action from 2015. And therefore, this weakness defines the return of the price into the major trading range. And where we have some hesitation here in the consumer staples, with telecommunications, we clearly see that we are in the middle of the range, and we see inability of the demand to lift the prices up.
OK, 那我们看到在这个阶段 A 和阶段 B 的时候，它这个价差增大，有可能价差，这个价差会比价差是从最高点到最低点了，会比在这个消费行业要多得多，也就是这点在下降波段的时候，这个下降这个 K 线价差增大是一个弱势的表现。第二个呢，就是在阶段 B 的时候，大家记得在消费行业它是上升的波段，它是上升的这个 trading range， 这个盘整区间，但是在这个电信业务行业呢，它是水平的。第三个呢，它画的是这个波段，在消费这个波段的时候，它上升的非常好，而且是突破了前期15年的高点。而在电信行业呢，它只突破了这个阶段性的这个高点，到了这点，它没有突破主高点2015年的主高点。然后从这里呢就可以看到它比消费行业要低得多，弱得多。然后呢再看到下降的时候，它也是下降的幅度是二分之一，到了这个交易区间的二分之一，要比消费的行业要多得多，要下跌的深得多。而且到最近的这一段时间，我们看到最近的表现呢，它的需求，也就是在这个红线这个成交量，需求量也比较低，说明需求的质量也不高，这都是弱的表现。而罗教授他写 W 的时候就是 weakness， 就是弱，比消费行业要弱得多。
This type of the analysis is called a comparative analysis, where we're comparing one instrument to another. We could compare a market to a sector. We could compare a sector to a sector. So we were just doing the comparison between the telecommunication services and consumer staples. And this analysis shows us that consumer staples is definitely a much better sector in terms of the leadership capacity throughout this whole chart. So this whole picture with the telecommunication services, and we see here a short-term move to the downside, a short-term downtrend, just basically suggests that if we are going to have a continuation of the move to the downside, this is probably a higher probability for this sector, you know, to go and to retest the area of the support where we have stopped the price action before from moving down. And obviously, compared to the consumer staples, even if consumer staples will go down, telecommunication services is going to be leading to the downside.
这种比较的方法呢叫做比较分析，也就是它用电信行业跟消费行业来进行比较。而这种比较分析呢，它可以用这个行业指数来跟大势比较，也可以用个股来跟大势比较，和个股跟行业比较，行业与行业之间比较都可以，也就是两个 K 线图放在一起它就可以比较。从上证电信业务行业来说，跟消费行业，他说这个上证电信呢是比较弱，大家看的比较弱。如果我们要挑一只比较强的股票呢，大家肯定要到消费行业去挑了。通过最近的情况来说，也就是说上证电信它在短期来说是一个下降波段，下降的这个通道，在这个通道里面，如果大势继续下跌的话，那么电信业务行业的下跌幅度恐怕要比消费行业要下跌的更深，更容易去测试前期的那两个低点。
Well, let's look at the daily just to see what kind of structure we have here. And on the daily, what's interesting, I thought we could go through this really quickly. Let's look at the distribution range that has happened here at the top of the rally.
那么看一下电信业务的日线图，这张图就更有意思了，因为我们首先呢看一下这个上面的派发区间和它的事件。
One of the interesting things how this distribution range has developed is that we have a very clear climactic run into the buying climax.
首先来说，在这个派发区间之前，我们看到一个它有一个非常清晰的向上狂热的上涨。
Yet I wanted to look at some analogous reactions. The first reaction to the downside that we have of the climactic high has the a relatively high supply signature, but relative to the previous points of where we had an attempt to move the price down, the result is actually increasing on the background where supply is slightly decreasing. So effort is decreasing, result is increasing. There is some kind of ease of movement that suggests a short-term bearish development.
大家观察一下这里面的成交量和价格结构的分析，他用这个三个点来做类比，来做类比分析，也就是在抢购高潮以后，它出现的这段波段里面，大家看到的成交量是要比前两次下降波段的成交量要稍微低一点，但是它的下降幅度和它的 K 线的这个价差要比前两次要多得多，所以说这就出现一种情况，也就是说它的努力比前两个阶段要小，但结果比前两个阶段要大，这有点像什么呢？就是说更容易向下移动，所以说叫 ease of movement， 就是更容易向下移动。所以说我们说这代表短期来说，是比较熊的意味。
Now imagine having this information at this point of time where we see a slightly different move to the downside than we saw before. And that comes after the climactic run that we've experienced. So that suggests some kind of short-term bearishness and continuation of this reaction. And as this reaction develops, we are comparing this reaction to all of the previous reactions that we see since the low. And we see how this reaction is so much larger. And it does have the change of character characteristics, suggesting that we are going to change the environment from uptrend to a trading range.
然后罗教授讲了几点比较细微的地方。首先呢，我们要看到这段的时候，我们要看到它是通过这段疯狂的上涨以后出现的情况。通过这三张 K 线图呢，也就是说。成交量没有以前高，但是结果却比以前大了，我们大家非常小心，因为它是经过了一段疯狂上涨，然后出现了这种现象，然后经过这段波段的发展以后，我们发现它这个下调的幅度已经超过了原来所有的调整幅度，所以说我们说哎，这段有可能是特性改变哦。那么我们要观察特性改变，就说什么什么，说明它前一段时间的上涨的这个大波段有可能会结束，后面的波段的发展啊，这个股价的发展有可能会前面不一样了。
Now let's compare the next moves to the upside, right? So we had a climactic run, we had an upthrust run, and then we had a test to the upthrust run.And every time the price moves, it contracts the thrust to the upside. And on the test, we just see a small tail that maybe slightly, ever slightly overcomes the upthrust high. And there is no progression behind a lot of effort that we see. Look at the area of the effort here.And effort is definitely increasing, it's more consistent, but yet the result is less, so that's bearish. And then on the next test, the effort signature is somewhat the same on average. And yet, what do we see? We see that the result is contracting even more. So this becomes even more bearish and suggests that the price is going to go lower.
这更是熊市的意味，熊市的意味更加增浓了。Sorry,
Mike, I deleted this. I thought that you were done. But continuing with this whole theme, after the test, look what happens next. In this area, this spread, the down spread, is increasing so much relative to the down spread that we have had before. And not only that, the volume signature on that is relatively high. So we see that the effort might be close to what we've had before, and yet result is increasing in the direction of the reaction. So again, that not only confirms that we are bearish at this point, but that the price is going to start moving down now in a much freer manner.
那么罗教授讲。 刚才大家看到了这个上升波段，也就是到最后这个测试波段的时候，它要比前两个波段都弱得多。那么大家开始向下降波段，那么经过这个测试波段非常弱的情况下，熊市一个非常浓的情况下，大家看一个开线它有多么的强，一天它的价差会那么大。而且呢，大家看那个努力，也就是它的成交量，成交量的时候，其实和以前的最高量都差不多。
所以说，他说努力和以前相仿，但是结果比以前要大得多，下降的波段要大得多，所以说这是更强的熊市意味。And then the price goes down into the low of the major sign of weakness. All of the attempts to go up fail, and the last momentum to the upside that is being developed is being tested with the lower effort and lower result. So that suggests again a continuation and continuation in a bearish manner.
经过前面的熊市意味和熊市信号以后，那么股价下跌到弱势信号这个点位，到这个点位以后，大家回看一下紧接下来的上升波段。 这个上升波段一波比一波弱，或者是非常弱，都比较相似，比较弱。那么到最后派发点的这个上升波段的时候，大家看这个上升波段，它是最后的动量测试，最后一波上升。上升完以后呢，到了这一块是对前面那个波段的最后派发点这个上升这个波段的测试，看这个测试，这个时候它的成交量比以前减低了。大家看这样，这个成交量要比最后这个动能测试这个动量最后。 派发点的这个需求量要低得多，而且呢，它的结果，也就是说它上升这个距离，也要比这个结果要弱得多。这时候熊市意味更加浓厚。
Now, before we talk about the most current price action, let me point your attention all or also to a very interesting characteristic that Chinese market in general has. And I think it all relates to the rules where you can't, you know, sell short the stock. You can only close your position. And Mike, please correct me if I'm wrong. But if we are looking here at the different periods of volume signature, we kind of could see where big institutions are most active. We're seeing that it's in this second zone that their presence is so much more visible. So what are they doing here? As we went through the distribution, that suggested that to us that big institutions are actually sold off their positions in this area in anticipation that the price is going to go down. And then as they've done this, look at area number three. There is really nothing's going on there. And the price, it just basically moves to the downside without any significant increase in the volume signature. So this is a very slight detail, but I think it's so crucial for the Chinese markets to understand of how institutions are being bound by the rules of the market, and therefore how volume signature is going to be shown to us on all of the charts.
罗教授在说最近的这个特点之前啊，先讲一下这个量价图和中国股市的特点，因为在其他国家，比方说在美国，它的是可以做空的，所以说即使是在下降波段，成交量也可能会很高或者怎么样。 而在这个中国股市呢，大家基本上来说是不可以做空，只能做多。到一定阶段的时候，只能是卖出，哎，我把这个卖出了，就不管了。所以说，大家看到第一个阶段和第二个阶段，它有显著不同和第三个阶段显著不同在于什么呢？第一个阶段是不断的吸筹，这时候成交量都比较低，比较低迷，大家看不出来，庄家也不愿意让你看它的迹象。而到了第二阶段的时候， 是庄家最活跃的阶段，而这个阶段呢，就是说成交量非常高、非常大。而第二个阶段完成以后，是庄家已经把筹码卖出了，也就是他们已经派发完毕，庄家已经不再参与了。到了第三阶段的时候，大家可以看到它的成交量是非常低迷的。
Now let's look at the most recent range and recent price action. As the price went down to the climactic action, and here we could say that this is a selling climax. We could also assume that this could be an intermediate selling climax, not a terminal selling climax. We'll talk about this distinction later on. And then the rally that comes next has the characteristics of the change of character. So what are we changing from and what are we changing to? So we are changing from the down move to a trading range environment or a consolidating environment. And as the price unfolds in this range, and we see here how it unfolds through the automatic reaction and a secondary test, we need to understand what kind of bias characteristics we could identify as the price moves.
那我们看到最近的情况发展，最近的情况呢，首先，迅速下跌以后，到了一个地方，我们把它叫做抛售高潮。这个抛售高潮完了以后呢，是有一个自动上涨波段，我们把它叫做特性改变。这个特性改变就是说，和以前的下降波段和上升波段来讲，它特性改变了，也就是下降波段有可能会进入到一个盘整波段。 这个抛售高潮呢，有可能它只是一个中间的抛售高潮，而不是最终的抛售高潮。将来情况我们再探讨、再发展、再看。自动上涨完以后，到了这个阻力线，阻力位以后，它开始二次测试，测试的什么？测试的是还有没有抛售的量超过抛售高潮这个点。
So looking at the rally that we have had here, it looks like a really good rally. But there are some of the things that are of concern to us, Wyckoffians, you know, about this rally. The first thing is that we see a consistent decrease in the demand signature as the rally develops. The second thing that we could see here is that the rally stops in the area of this support cluster that was created by the automatic reaction and a sign of weakness lows, and it has inability to advance beyond that and coming back into the previous trading range where we had some selling taking place.
大家看这个最新波段的这段上涨阶段，这段上涨阶段看似，哎，上涨幅度挺大，而且它的K线也比较大，但是有两个事情大家要看到，第一呢，就是它的成交量，在上涨波段的时候，这个K线的成交量是逐渐减低的，也就是它的需求并不高。第二呢，大家看到它这个上涨到达的顶点是什么？是前一波的低点。
The next thing that happens is that we have an absolutely quick decline back into the support area. So it took us some time to produce this result, and yet it takes us a much shorter time to negate all of the profits. And then on the next rally, we are expecting that the next rally maybe would advance beyond the resistance point that was created by the first rally. Yet, this rally creates a lower high, which is obviously not a good sign for the bulls. And that happens also on the relatively low demand signature.
大家看最近的这个下降波段，它呢又比较快，快速的测试了底部 它的用所用的天数要比上升那个从抛售高潮到自动上涨这个上升时候所用的天数要少得多，也就是比较快速。然后经过二次测试以后，这个股价开始自动再上涨，再往上测试上面的这个成交量怎么样？啊，不是，sorry，在测试它的这个需求量怎么样，能走到哪？结果它没有走到前期的顶点，而这个股价只上升了一大半。
All right, so we would be expecting that the price most likely will retest the lows as there is some kind of momentum, you know, to the downside, there is some selling, and there is inability to go to the previous high. So I wouldn't be surprised if the price would try to retest this low.
刚才罗老师还讲到一个问题啊，对我忘了翻了，然后现在补上，也就是在这个上升波段的时候，大家看到这个成交量还是非常低，也就是说它的需求还是不是很高，所以说通过这一点来说，它又形成了比较低的顶，而且呢成交量这个向上的需求量也比较低，那么有可能呢将来的趋势有可能会再次测试这个底部。
Of course, as I mentioned before, with the tariff war between the US, United States, and China, we need to keep in mind that news play a big role right now in the market. So if the sentiment shifts to a positive sentiment where maybe there is some kind of agreement between the American and Chinese governments on how they're going to deal with this tariff problem, then the market could rally significantly, and we just have to keep this in mind. But so far, technically, we are in the short-term downtrend, and we would be expecting that the price is going to retest at least the levels of the support.
当然了，大家都知道，最近的市场是新闻市，也就是根据这个贸易战相关性比较大，很多股市的走向呢。 都跟消息相关，有好消息的时候，市场会上升；有坏消息的时候，市场会猛然间下跌。所以说这个消息对近期的股价影响比较大。但单从我们抛出消息来说，单从技术分析的角度来说，目前来说它还是在一个下降通道之内，有可能从技术分析单纯的技术分析来说，它还非常有可能测试 前期的这个底部。
Okay, let's look at the last sector. And this one will be a quick one because there is really not a lot to talk about here. We definitely see again a lot of the weakness at the beginning of the decline in 2015. We also see the inability to rally around this area at the late 2015 and then making a lower low, a new, more significant lower low than any of the sectors that we looked at. So the climactic action actually is quite lower than what we've seen. And again, I am observing the same distribution signature where institutions are distributing in one area, and then they basically do not participate in the next move to the downside.
几个行业比较来说都比较弱，更加弱。从第一个来说，它这个第一个波段的时候下降的时候就下降比较快，这点来说是非常弱。第二个呢，就是说它其他的这个行业到这儿来基本上来说比较终止了，但是在公共事业里面它暂停了一下以后又一个下降波段，这个是很多行业没有的，也就是说它比其他的行业更加弱一点。做完以后呢，它基本上来说是在一个水平的通道内运动，而且呢，大家罗教授刚才讲了这个成交量，这个成交量里面从这个顶点到一直到这儿，他看到的是机构的派发，机构派发完以后，基本上来说机构基本上已经不太活跃了，在这个行业里面。
And we see some other elements of weakness. The automatic rally is not that strong. We don't see the consolidation having a more positive resolution. There is no rally out of that consolidation. And then as the price goes down, we are residing at the lows of the support.
后来的这段区间呢，大家看到也是它比其他行业弱。首先来说，在自动上涨的时候，它没有比其他行业上涨的那么幅度那么高。然后在阶段 B 的时候呢，就是说经过了盘整以后，前期的盘整以后，阶段 B 大家记得在消费行业它是一直上升的这个通道里面，而在公用事业里面它基本上是一个水平的通道，稍有上升但不大。但最近的情况来说，在其他的行业或者是形成一个水平的交易区间或者怎么样的时候，而在这个公用事业它的交易区间它基本上的趋势是向下的。
And even though I'm putting here both of the scenarios, one is a potential spring, and if we have more positive news, maybe move to the upside. But I think it's the second scenario where we have some kind of inability to go higher, and everything seems to be in the downtrend still, that most likely will develop. And we just have to look at the daily and to see if we could find the confirmation to one or another scenario.
由于股价还没有突破这个整个的通道的时候，所以说罗老师把两种情况都标出来。第一种情况呢，就是说目前的这个情况有可能是弹簧效应 spring 和 test 和测试。第二种情况呢，就是已经稍稍突破了这个平衡的交易通道。交易区间形成的有可能是弱势信号，但它更加倾向，由于最近你看这个股票比较弱，而且也不能够挺起来，所以它更倾向于可能是第二种情况，而且它画了一个交易通道，虚线的交易通道是向下的。
Let's look at the daily.
那么看一下日线。
And here we see this last attempt to upthrust above the long-term resistance, and then a very urgent distribution both on the way up and then on the way down by institutions. We see the institutional signature right here in this area. The retail traders cannot create this type of signature. They just don't have this significant size behind their effort. And then everything else, again, is where the volume generally goes goes lower. So there is a very low institutional participation in this area, suggesting that they're just not in the positions and they are not buyers. So if they are not in the position and they are not buyers, so therefore the price is going to just gradually go down.
通过日线图里面呢，大家可以看到，首先这个急涨，也就是说大家记得这个原来的交易通道是一个水平的，然后在这里面呢出现了一个上冲回落，上冲回落的这个急涨波段，这个急涨波段以后呢，大家看一下成交量，这个成交量非常高，也就是罗老师说，他在这个急涨波段和下降波段里都看到了大机构庄家的脚印，也就是在这段波成交量的时候，不管是上涨还是下降，都非常大，这是 机构和庄家的这个迹象，散户来说是没有那么大的成交量的，只有他们才有那么大的成交量，而且这些成交量都是派发的成交量，在即使它是上升的过程中，它也是在不断的卖，它只是借用这个上升的趋势在出售筹码而已，而卖完以后，大家看到成交量都非常低了，这个时候庄家的参与度就非常少了。 基本上来说，庄家都已经快跑光了，留下的恐怕也只是少量。在没有庄家的情况下，那么整个行业它的股价就会逐渐的往下走，慢慢的下跌。
And look, since the high, look at the all of the rallies that happen, and we see that on each of the rally, there is some kind of contraction of the result on all of those rallies, which suggests that there is no demand behind all of these rallies. And if there is some demand, it's of poor quality. It's really not of institutional quality. So, and we see how every time there is an attempt to go down, there is some kind of failure. And then failure again. So that's inherently bearish.
大家再看，经过机构派发以后，它在大家再观察一下这些上升波段，这些上升波段有一个特点，就是说它们的质量都不是很高。首先来说呢，它上升完以后，它这个股价开始回调，它都试图 停止在这个回调这个波段，但每次来说它都失败，回调到这儿来，然后试图停住停稳，然后都失败，而且它的成交量也都非常低，大家看到没有？也就是说，上升波段的质量不高，试图终止，试图能在那上继续停止，每次都失败，然后继续下滑，这都是弱势表现。
Now it seems that the last rally has this ability to rally in a different way. It has a different character. And especially, it's nice that it comes after what looks like somewhat of the climactic action, which is also, interestingly enough, is being based on the support that was created by all of these points of the resistance and support prior to that. So look how precisely we are going into the oversold condition and overthrowing this to the downside.
大家有人说了，哎，这段最近的这段上涨，质量不错呀，你看它涨得很好啊，它这个罗老师讲，大家看到这个最近这段上涨啊，其实是刚好从这个超卖这个K线开始的，而超卖的K线呢，看到它非常符合整个的这个下降通道。
Now, as we talk about this rally, we always think about the intention. What is the intention that's behind this rally? And if it has such a great characteristic where maybe demand is slightly increasing and we are traveling much better than any of the rallies before that we've seen in the downtrend, our intention will be to overcome some levels of the resistance, which will be here, here, and somewhere here. And yet, what do we do here? the result is actually is failing to commit the price above that level. And then after that, there is a very quick move to the downside with some selling that is associated on this particular bar. So all of the gains that we gained here are quickly negated in the next move to the downside.
大家看这段上涨的时候，那么我们要分析一下什么呢？就是这段上涨的目的是什么？它这段时间对买家的目的是什么？如果说
There is a big sound.
Sorry about the noise. 对不起大家，那个刚才有点噪音啊，现在好了。那么我们要谈到的是这段上涨波段的目的是什么？如果说这段上涨有很好的需求的话，那么罗老师画了一个比较虚的东西，其实没有这段很高的成交量。如果这个需求量很大，那么说我们就探讨这个目的。那么这个需求在很大的需求下，我们希望它的目的是突破前期的阻力线。也就这个阻力线，要么是这个位置，要么这个位置，或者是比较大的这个波段的这个阻力线，我们希望有一个很好的需求来突破这些阻力。那么我们说 ，OK， 它跟以前下降通道的目的已经不一样了，它特性改变了。但是我们看到它的成交量第一没有那么高，第二它是根本就没有达到阻力线，然后就迅速开始下跌，而且是有一个跳空下跌，而这次。跳空下跌到目前为止，它恐怕把前期的上涨的波幅度都已经抵消了。
The last point on this chart, that we could make is the next attempt to go up, and yet we don't have any ability to even come to the point of the resistance here, in the down channel, and we're quickly being rejected. From that price, so most likely we will be retesting the lows in this area right here.
那么大家看最近的这波上涨，然后我们它如果说它比较强的话，它最少要去测试上面的那个阻力线，但是呢，它根本就没有能力到达上面的阻力线，而迅速的回转又开始下跌了。那么通过这一点来说，我们说它很有可能。会继续测试这两个低点。
All right, everyone. This is it for today's session from Wyckoff Trading Institute. We hope that you have enjoyed it. And big thank you to Jer Gobin for translation. And thank you very much for all of the emails that you're sending us. To wyckofftrading@hotmail.com. Hopefully, with more sessions, we will find a better process of how we deliver the knowledge to you in a better visual way and also with the slides and better announcements as to when the video comes out. As a rule, we generally look at 1 week period where we want to post the video. So thank you again for watching, for listening, and thank you for all of your emails. Mike, thank you so much.
今天的视频呢，就到这里。然后首先呢，我们要感谢大家的参与，希望大家能够喜欢我们的视频。第二呢，我们也非常感谢你们给我们留下留言，或者是给我们发邮件。希望大家继续给我们发邮件，我们邮件是wyckofftrading@hotmail.com。然后呢，希望将来我们能够增加联系，把你的想法告诉我们，然后呢，我们也迅速呢，在我们上传的录像以后呢，跟大家迅速能够告诉大家，希望能够大家有更多的联系和这种交流，而且我们将来也希望能够根据大家的想法，你们想要学什么，或者是你们的重点在哪里，都告诉我们，我们都可以根据你们的需求来调整我们的视频内容。
Thank you very much again, and bye bye.
好，再次感谢。好，大家下期见。